Learning Seminar Series. Today's topic is Approach to PLHIV with CNS Manifestation, and speaker is Dr. K. Ravi. Dr. Ravi is Professor of Department of Medicine, Bangalore Medical College and Research Institute, with over 15 years of experience. He is also the Program Director of the COE and Nodal Officer of ART Center, Boring and Lady Curzon Hospital, Bengaluru. He is actively involved in comprehensive PLHIV care, support and treatment at the same hospital. Under his guidance and mentorship, 16 various national NACO training programs were conducted at the COE. We welcome you, sir, for today's session. Now I request Dr. Ravi to take over the session.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I bring greetings from ART Center, Boring and Lady Curzon Hospital and Center of Excellence, Boring and Lady Curzon Hospital, attached to Bangalore Medical College. Thank HITECH and NACO for giving us an opportunity to speak in this National Distance Learning Seminar Series. We'll discuss today about approach to PLHIV with CNS manifestations. As you all are aware, the HIV invades the central nervous system fairly early during the course of infection and progresses with advancement of the infection. It affects all part of the neuronal axis, that is the central nervous system and even the peripheral nervous system. Virtually all patients with HIV have some degree of CNS involvement. Studies have shown that CSF findings are abnormal in 90% of patients, even in asymptomatic individuals. HIV is the most common viral infection of the nervous system, affecting both central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. Up to 50% of patients with HIV have clinically apparent neurological disease. Up to 20% of the patients present for the first time with neurological manifestations. Up to 90% of the HIV patients have neuropathological changes on autopsy. India has the second largest burden of HIV-related pathology next to the sub-Saharan Africa. Neurological complications associated with HIV infections are very common in our clinical setting. Some of these patients may develop multiple CNS opportunistic infections in advanced immunodeficiency. Same patients can have cryptococcal meningitis and even a TB meningitis in the same patient. How does this virus affect the central nervous system? This HIV affects the central nervous system directly as a result of action of the affection of the virus on the parts of the central nervous system, or indirectly occurring as a result of opportunistic infections. This direct effect of the HIV virus affects usually by damaging the perivascular macrophages, monocytes and the microglial cells. The indirect effect of the HIV on the central nervous system is mainly occurring as a result of opportunistic infection. Several opportunistic infections have been noted depending on the immunological status of the individual in that particular patient. This is the classification of the neurological disease in a patient living with HIV. As I told you, it directly affects the HIV infection directly affects the central nervous system. The direct affection of the central nervous system, it can be presented as aseptic meningitis. Aseptic meningitis can affect the central nervous system in any part of the HIV disease. Next is the HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders called as the HAND. This can vary from asymptomatic individual to more advanced AIDS dementia complex. This AIDS dementia complex can present as an AIDS-defining illness. The HIV can affect directly the central nervous system, that is the spinal cord, mainly in the form of vascular myelopathy, where the patient can have long tract signs, pyramidal tract signs, ataxia, pure sensory ataxia, paresthesias, and dysesthesias. Involvement of the peripheral nerves is very common in patients with the direct affection of the HIV disease. Again, it can affect the peripheral nervous system in any stage of the disease, in the acute stage and even in the more advanced stage. Here you have to remember it can manifest to you as AIDP, where cases of GB syndrome have been reported along with the patient with HIV. Chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy has to be, HIV has to be kept one of the DDs in patients with CIDP. It can present as mononeuritis, multiplex, and distal symmetrical polyneuropathy. In addition to these things, peripheral neuropathy, you should be very careful. The drugs we use for the treatment of HIV itself can also cause peripheral neuropathy. That also has to be kept in mind. In addition, the associated disease like diabetes, alcohol, all of them also can cause peripheral neuropathy. The HIV disease directly affects the muscle also, where it can cause asymptomatic elevation of the CPK to many muscle disease. If you go to the opportunistic infections, this opportunistic infections depend on the immunological status of the individual. They can present to you with as toxoplasmosis, cryptococcosis, multiple progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, PML, or cytomegalovirus infection, infection to tuberculosis, mycobacterium, HTLE infection, and amoebiasis. So these infections occur as depending on the CD4 count in that particular individuals. You can also have neoplasms like primary CNS lymphoma and Kaposi sarcoma, though Kaposi sarcoma is rare in our part of the country. The pathogenesis, how this virus affects the central nervous system, damage to the CNS may be direct result of the viral infection of the CNS macrophage or the glial cells, or secondary to the release of neurotoxins and potentially toxic cytokines such as interleukin 1b, TNF-alpha and interleukin 6 can directly secondarily affect the central nervous system. This is the neurological manifestations of various neurological manifestation in a patient with HIV really in relation to the immunological status. As you can see in the early stage of the disease, when the immunological status is good and the CD4 count is more than 500, you usually see the seroconversion syndrome like meningitis, meningoencephalitis, myelitis, and even the peripheral neuropathy in the form of AIDP or brachial plexopathy and rhabdomyolysis. With advancing disease, with the decreased immunosuppression, decreased CD4 count, you get more of the HIV-related illness like HIV-AIDS-defining illness like HIV dementia, cryptococcal meningitis, toxoplasmosis, PML, vascular myopathy were affecting the spinal cord. Even encephalitis syndromes are usually seen in the advanced. This is in relation to the immunological status of the individual. Classification. Of the, as I told you in the initial slide, it can affect both the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system. This is a classification based on the neuroanatomical localization and the clinical syndrome associated. HIV can affect the brain, the meninges, the spinal cord, the peripheral nerves, and even the muscle. We'll go individually each one by one. HIV, can I told you, can affect the brain directly. As when it affects the brain, what are the syndromes or the symptoms which usually produces? When the HIV affects the brain, it can cause HIV encephalopathy, AIDS dementia complex, progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, tuberculosis. The one in red are usually the AIDS defining illnesses. It can also cause neurosyphilis and lymphoma. The HIV affecting the brain can also present to you as space occupying lesions. It could be abscesses due to tuberculosis, listeria, nocardia, and E. coli. It can be presenting as infective granulomas, where you can see toxoplasmosis, cryptococcosis, which we commonly come across. Neoplastic disease are quite common. Primary CNS lymphomas and metastatic Kaposi sarcoma also are seen. Others like PMLE and progressive multifocal varicella zoster and cytomegalovirus infections can also be present as a space-occupying lesion. HIV can the brain in the form of encephalitis, cytomegalovirus encephalitis, PMLE, herpes zoster, varicella zoster, herpes simplex, toxoplasma encephalitis can also cause encephalitis-like picture in a patient with HIV. Stroke-like syndromes are also very common in these patients with HIV when it affects the brain. Stroke can occur as a result of hemorrhage or even an ischemic stroke. Both of them can manifest in a patient with HIV. Next are the neurological manifestation of HIV involving the meninges. As a result of involvement of the meninges, you can develop acute meningitis or even a chronic meningitis where the patient can present you with headache, vomiting, altered sensorium. Acute meningitis, it can be occur as a result of HIV seroconversion illness, where aseptic meningitis is the most common one. Meningitis due to pneumococcal and meningococcal organism, E. coli, Klebsiella organisms also are seen. Chronic meningitis, any patient presenting to you with signs of meningeal irritation, it can occur due to a chronic disease. It can be tuberculosis, Mycobacterium avium complex, cryptococcosis, infections. Another important thing is the metastatic meningitis, particularly the lymphomas, also should be kept in mind when you're dealing with these infection of the meninges. Neurological manifestation of the HIV as involving the spinal cord, the vascular myelopathy is the most common one, where it involves the long tracts, where the patient can present to you with pyramidal type of weakness and ataxia, particularly the sensory ataxia. Infections affecting the spinal cord in patient with HIV or the cytomegalovirus infection causing myelopathy, varicella zoster and herpes simplex viruses. Neoplastic disease can affect the spinal cord indirectly as a result of lymphoma or metastasis associated myelopathy. HIV patients are prone for deficiency state, particularly vitamin B12 deficiency. You have to keep vitamin B12 deficiency, that is subacute combined degeneration, as one of the DDs in a patient who present to you with spinal cord disease. HIV can affect the peripheral nerves. So as a result of peripheral nerves, the involvement in the early stage, you can get AIDP, the CIDP, vasculitic neuropathy, cranial mononeuropathy or multiple mononeuropathies. Even plexopathies are quite common in the early stages. The mechanism is being the immune dysregulation. In the mid stages, as a result of HIV replication, you can get distal sensory polyneuropathy, which is the most common type of peripheral neuropathy which we come across, and even autonomic neuropathy. Later stage, as a result of opportunistic infection, you can get various CMV, polyradiculopathy, mononeuritis multiplexa, lymphomatous polyradiculopathy, tuberculosis polyradiculopathies, and AIDS cachexia neuropathy also. One important thing which you have to remember when we are dealing with peripheral neuropathy is the usage of the drugs which we use for the therapy of anti-HIV, where your NRTIs can cause, like didoxins, cytarabine, can cause peripheral neuropathy. Other concomitant disease like diabetes and the use drugs used in the treatment of opportunistic infection like vincristin, INH, ethambutol also has to be kept when we are dealing with patients of peripheral neuropathy. So it's not just the HIV causing peripheral neuropathy. You have to think of the opportunistic infections, the drugs that are used in the treatment of opportunistic infections which cause this peripheral neuropathy. Neurological manifestation, it can also affect the muscles. Muscles, mainly it's the HIV polymyositis, CMV polymyositis, AIDS cachexia, HIV wasting syndrome can be seen. Another important thing is the use of zidovudine, where the patient can have asymptomatic elevation or of the CPK, or even mainly muscle disease can also be, we can come across in these patients. These are a few studies which show the different manifestations of central nervous system, which was one study was done in France and one study was done in Hyderabad. This study done by Pandey et al., where it's published in Indian Journal of Medical Research, where they did HIV burden in the year 2006, they saw various neurological manifestations that were present in a patient with HIV. This was done in NIMHANS and published in 2006 in the year Indian Journal of Medicine Research. They saw cryptococcosis constituted for almost 37.2%, followed by TB 31.9%. Dementia was seen in 1.4%, which was quite less compared to the Western counterpart, where it was on 30 to 40. And the other things like PML, myelopathy, and neoplasm were less common in this study, which was done in NIMHANS. There was one similar study, which was done in Hyderabad, the NIMS Hyderabad, where they also did a retrospective study done by Vijaya D. et al., published in AIDS 2055. Where they divided them into meningitis, mast lesions, neuropathy and myelopathy, where they saw they had almost 162 patients with meningitis like disease affecting the meningitis, where again they had TB meningitis 25%, cryptococcal meningitis 10%, pyogenic 1.9 and aseptic 1.95%. Mast lesions, majority of they had in their study was toxoplasmosis and tuberculoma, almost about 10%. lymphoma and PML. Lymphoma was next with 6.8% and PML in 1.7%. If you take the peripheral neuropathy in this study published by Hyderabad, mononeuritis multiplexa, distal symmetrical polyneuropathy, all were seen. Then they also had about 33 patients with myelopathy and dementia. So you can see HIV affects almost all the part of the central nervous system. Another data from Mumbai by Dr. Alka Deshpande, though not published in any journal. Again, they had around meningitis 75%, 75 patients, TBM 51, cryptococcal meningitis 24, CMV encephalitis, they had one. Mast lesion, again here it was toxoplasma and followed by tuberculosis. So we see number of cases of toxoplasmosis. So hence we should keep toxoplasmosis as one of the DDs in mast lesion. Myelopathy 2, neuropathy 24 and dementia, they had 4 cases and myopathy 1. Here they had a lot of patients with stroke which almost constitute around 20 cases. So these are the 3 different studies which picked up various neurological manifestations in HIV patient. We'll go to the commonly encountered neurological manifestations in a patient with living with HIV. The first among them I'll be discussing is the HIV-associated neurocognitive disorder. This is called as HAND in short. This varies in severity. The spectrum of the disorder ranges from asymptomatic neurocognitive impairment to clinically severe dementia. This patient, depending on the immunological status, may be asymptomatic. With advanced disease, fall in the CD4 count, they can develop neurocognitive disease to severe dementia, where it is AIDS dementia complex. This HIV-associated dementia, also referred to as AIDS dementia complex or encephalopathy, is considered as an AIDS-defining illness. This HIV encephalopathy in the era of heart, 10 to 20% of HIV patients are affected by it. It is the first manifestation of AIDS in about 3% of HIV patients, associated with CD4 count of less than 200 cells. It is considered as part of the HIV-associated neurocognitive impairment spectrum, as I told you. Varies from asymptomatic to AIDS dementia complex with progression of the disease, increase in the viral load and immune suppression, the disease advances. Pathologically, you see mainly there is pallor, multinucleated cell encephalitis and vascular changes that take place. The cerebral cortex is usually spared in these patients with HIV encephalopathy. Hence, these patients are also described as subcortical dementia. That is one way of differentiating the other causes of dementia, particularly Alzheimer's disease, where the apraxia, agnosia will be affected. In these patients, they are not usually affected. So the areas affected are subcortical structures of the brain and spinal cord, hence called as the subcortical dementia. If you take the clinical features, they can progress from cognitive impairment, where they'll have forgetfulness, decreased attention and concentration, inability to perform complex tasks, mania and agitation. With advancement, motor abnormalities or motor dysfunction in the form of gait disturbances, poor balance in the form of ataxia, slowness of movement, tremors, choreoformic movements and myoclonic jerks are common. With advancement, again the patient will go into a vegetative state where the patient is unable to ambulate. Bowel and bladder incontinence are quite common. There is a staging system for this HIV-associated dementia or HAND, where the staged by Frascati criteria. Here they usually stage it as asymptomatic, mild neurocognitive disorder and HIV-associated dementia. Here for testing these, the neurocognitive status and the functional status, the neurocognitive testing should include assessment of at least 5 domains, including attention, information processing, the language, abstraction, executive, complex perceptual motor skills, memory, simple motor skills or sensory perceptual skills. Appropriate norms must be available to establish the number of domains in which performance is below one standard deviation. The functional status is usually typically assessed by self-reporting but might be corroborated by a collateral source. Note that the diagnosis of HIV-associated neurocognitive disorder other causes of dementia must be ruled out, and potential confounding factor effects of substance use or even psychiatric illness should be considered when you are dealing with these patients with HIV-associated neurocognitive disorder, or in short, the HAND. So they are staged usually on asymptomatic, mild neurocognitive disorder, and HIV-associated dementia. How will you investigate these patients? You should have a baseline MMSE to make a diagnosis of this neurocognitive disorder. All patients should be done a mini mental score examination. It is advisable in all patients with HIV to have a baseline MMSE. With progression or advancement, the patient, as I told you, can have motor abnormalities and advanced HIV encephalopathy. CT and MRI might show diffuse cerebral atrophy, patchy or a diffuse abnormal signals, especially on the flare-weighted images. CSF are usually non-specific. The lumbar puncture findings are usually non-specific. CSF is usually done to rule out other viral infections. The CSF finding, sugar is usually normal, protein is mildly elevated, cells will show lymphocytic pleocytosis. These are quite common with many of the asymptomatic individuals also. So these are usually non-specific. Special tests like HIV immunoglobulin G synthesis, oligoclonal bands, and HIV DNA amplification can be done. It's only for academic interest. Diagnosis is based mainly on the clinical suspicion of the patient. Elevated levels of macrophage chemoattractant proteins, that is MCP1, beta-2 microglobulin, neoptrin, and quinolic acid may be noted. That is, elevated level of these things may be noted in these patients with HIV dementia. The practical utility of these special tests is uncertain, and there is no absolute correlation between CSF HIV burden and the disease severity. This is one of the CT image which usually shows, you can see the patient presented with early signs of AIDS-related dementia, which was apparently appears normal. And the next film over here, you can see 11 months or later, marked brain atrophy is seen with dilatation of the ventricle. So you have to keep it in mind that the patient suspicion of HIV dementia, if you have a baseline MMSE, follow them up. If the patient is having neuropsychiatric abnormalities, you should suspect and make a diagnosis. Treatment. Use of antiretroviral therapy improves neuropsychological performance. Up to 50% reduction in HIV encephalopathy since the introduction of HART. Simpler regimens should be used with minimal side effects. Drugs with CSF penetration should be used. Majority of them, like zidovudine, stavudine, lamivudine, efavirenz, and nevirapine, have got good CNS penetration. Use of these drugs has definitely shown improvement in the neuropsychological performance or the prevention of the development of AIDS-associated dementia. Neuroleptic medication for patients with psychobehavioral disease, they have increased sensitivity to develop extrapyramidal system side effects. So they should be used in caution in these patients because of EPS side effects. Tricyclic antidepressant and SSRIs have been tried. Clozapine and haloperidol can be tried for the treatment of this neuroleptic, this HIV-associated neurological disease. Anticonvulsants like gabapentin and topiramate are usually sometimes used. Psychological support and assisted living of assisting them in living is very important part of the treatment of these patients with HIV-associated dementia. Next is the aseptic meningitis, very common. 10 to 15% of patients with acute HIV seroconversion illness present with meningitis. Pathophysiology is immune mediated. It can affect all parts of the, all stages of the HIV. They usually present with headache, signs of meningeal irritation. They can present in the acute seroconversion illness like flu, like febrile illness. All alertness and cognition can be preserved, may be associated with features of encephalitis. In some cases, cranial nerve involvement like 7, rarely 5 or even 8 can be involved. Investigation, when you suspect a patient with aseptic meningitis, again, CSF analysis. CSF analysis might be normal, sugars is normal, protein is only minimally elevated with less than 100 cells, predominant lymphocyte that is only about 0 to 5 cells. Additional testing like intrathecal anti-HIV immunoglobulin, serum P24 capture assay and HIV RNA level can be done. However, it is not beneficial. Usually, majority of them are usually self-limiting, resolves in 2 to 4 weeks without any treatment, aseptic meningitis. So you should suspect patients with aseptic meningitis in the initial stage, during the stage of seroconversion, and even in the advanced stage. Next most common opportunistic infection that we see in our clinical practice, cryptococcal meningitis. Majority of them are missed out because we don't do appropriate investigation. Cryptococcus neoformans infections are rare among healthy people, 0.4 to 1.3 cases per lakh general population per year. Worldwide, estimated 1 million cases of cryptococcal meningitis per year among PL-HIV. That is very, very high, you should see, remember. Deaths due to cryptococcal meningitis, nearly 6,25,000 deaths occur. The greatest burden is in the sub-Saharan Africa, where mortality is estimated to be almost 50 to 70%. In the US and other developed nations, the incidence of cryptococcus has been decreasing due to availability and initiation of HART. In the US, the mortality is around only 12%. If you see this in the diagrammatic representation, this was published by Park BJ et al. You can see majority of the cryptococcal meningitis are seen in sub-Saharan Africa. Next is our East and Southeast Asia, where is the next in line. What is the burden of this disease in India? It's difficult to estimate the exact incidence. There were a few studies to know the prevalence of cryptococcal meningitis in a patient living with HIV. There were three studies which was done, one by Bharatkar et al. Mumbai, Malay et al. In Mangalore in 2012, and Manoharan et al. In Perundurai 2001. Each of them had different prevalence. You see in Bharatkar in Mumbai had only prevalence of 2.7%. Mahale et al. In Mangalore had a prevalence of 16.6%. And prevalence in the Manoharan et al. Was 34.8%. So it varies from place to place. However, we should remember it's an important opportunistic infection among Indian patients, underdiagnosed among our patients. We should make attempt to send the CSF sample or ask for the India Inc. preparation in all patients with chronic meningitis. Identification is very, very important because mortality rates are very high. It's an initial AIDS-defining illness in about 2% of the patients. More common with severe immunosuppression, that is CD4 cell of less than 100. It presents as a subacute onset. Any patient with chronic meningitis, keep DD as cryptococcal meningitis. Signs of meningeal irritation like fever, stiffness, vomiting, cryptococcomas and cranial nerve involvement are rarely seen. Head-to-toe examination in these patients in whom you are suspecting of cryptococcal meningitis. They can have skin lesions like molluscum contagiosum, palatal ulcers and oral ulcers, myocarditis, pulmonary involvement. They can have fever, cough in 1/3 of the cases, gastroenteritis. They can present with vomiting, loose motion, and prostatitis in particularly males. This prostate may serve as a reservoir of this smoldering infection of cryptococcal meningitis. So clinical features, if you see these, there are various studies which were done and published, about one in 97, 98 and 2003. If you see the clinical features, majority of them had headache in all the three studies, and fever followed by fever 48%, 51% and 78%. Focal neurological deficit was seen in 20% by this study but done by Mosa et al. And this had only 8%, that is Robert Sydenham et al. In 1988. Then Prasad et al. Showed only 20% of them had neurological deficit. So this is the varied manifestations or the clinical features with which the patient can present to you with cryptococcal meningitis. Investigation, you suspect the patient to have cryptococcal meningitis. Any patient with signs and symptoms of meningitis, chronic or subacute in onset, suspect cryptococcal meningitis, do a CSF analysis. If you do the CSF analysis, again, probably you might not pick up anything, just a routine CSF analysis. Sugars will be decreased, proteins will be elevated, and the cells can have just mononuclear pleocytosis. You might not make a definitive diagnosis of cryptococcal meningitis. You subject them for India Inc. preparation. Again, there you'll have a lot of differential diagnosis. So you should do a CSF cryptococcal antigen, which has got a sensitivity of 95%. But in our resource limited countries, it is enough to do a India-ing preparation where you can, in the background of an immunosuppressed individual, you can make a diagnosis of cryptococcal meningitis. Fungal CSF culture is the gold standard for diagnosis of cryptococcal meningitis. Conventional microbiology test, I told you, microscopy, that is the India Inc. antigen detection and the culture. This is the India Inc. where you can see a negative staining of the capsule with a narrow base. It's very easy. It's a staining technique. The stain accentuates only the polysaccharide capsule. It's a simple, easy to perform, relatively inexpensive test where it can be done in all center. Specificity is 100%. Sensitivity is about 75% to 80%. Majority of the diagnosis of cryptococcal meningitis are based on this India Inc. preparation. Cryptococcal antigen detection by latex agglutination and ELISA. You need trained personnel. Recently, you are also doing lateral flow assay available. But however, LFA is very inexpensive and should be accessible even in the resource limited countries. But at present, we are not dependent on doing the cryptococcal antigen. Antigen might even persist even after completion of treatment for a variable time. Culture, as I already told, it's the gold standard, 100% specific and 50 to 70% sensitive. Needs to at least 72 hours of incubation. Usually reports available in about 3 to 5 days. So these are the comparison of the sensitivity of various diagnostic tests, India Inc., CSF culture and CSF latex agglutination. You see culture is almost 100% sensitivity in almost all these studies. India Inc. also is quite sensitive, 91%, 87%, 87%, only in one study which had around 60%. Latex agglutination again 100%, 100%. So if you have India Inc. preparation, probably we can, in our resource limited setting, we can do a diagnosis of a cryptococcal meningitis. This is a CT which shows a gelatinous pseudo cyst formation. This is a complication of a cryptococcal meningitis. It's not a finding of a cryptococcal meningitis, showing a gelatinous pseudo cyst formed by the confluence of dilated perivascular spaces. This is the CT finding in a complication of a cryptococcal meningitis. So once you have diagnosed cryptococcal meningitis, you have to treat these patients. Treatment, amphotericin B, 0.7 to 1 milligrams once daily, IV infusion for 14 to 21 days, followed by fluconazole, 400 milligrams once daily, orally for 8 to 10 weeks. Then fluconazole, 200 milligrams once daily, orally, till CD4 count increased to more than 200 after ART initiation and sustained for at least 6 months. Word of caution, using amphotericin B, the patient might develop a flu-like syndrome with fever, body ache. Do not stop it. Continue with anti-inflammatory measures. However, when you are using amphotericin B, be caution about the renal insufficiency, the hypokalemia, and the hypomagnesemia. Advise the patient to take a lot of fluids after the infusion. Hydrate him adequately so that you prevent the renal insufficiency. Then follow it up by fluconazole. Some centers, they use fluconazole as the only drug for the treatment of amphotericin B. However, it is not advisable to use fluconazole. Is not the drug of choice. Amphotericin is the drug of choice for treatment of cryptococcal meningitis. Initiation of ART, immediate ART initiation is not recommended in HIV infected patients with cryptococcal meningitis due to the high risk of IRIS, which may be life threatening. ART initiation should be deferred until there is a evidence of sustained clinical response and antifungal therapy. The next important is the toxoplasmosis, next common opportunistic infection. This toxoplasmosis associated with CD4 cell count of less than 100 cells, most common cause of focal intracranial mass lesion in patients with HIV. It almost always occurs as a recrudescence of a previously acquired infection. Sometimes the individual could have acquired the infections. Hence, that is said to be more common, 10 times more common in patients with antibodies to toxoplasmosis. They can present to you. Hence, actually, some books recommend the screening of all patients with HIV for the antibodies to toxoplasmosis. Hence, those individuals can be prevented by developing toxoplasmosis. Clinical features, they present with fever, headache, and focal neurological deficit like seizures, hemiparesis, and aphasia. Rarely, patient may have confusion, dementia, lethargy, and coma. Investigations when you suspect a patient with a focal neurological deficit in a patient with retroviral disease, suspect toxoplasmosis, one of the differential diagnoses, do a CT or an MRI. Multiple lesions in multiple location is the characteristic feature. Ring enhancing lesion, inflammation and central necrosis. IgG antibodies to toxoplasma. This should be done for all HIV patients at the time of initial workup. You see, these patients are usually prone to develop toxoplasmosis is said to be more common in these patients with antibodies. Brain biopsy is not recommended. It's only confirmatory test. Those patients in whom you suspected toxoplasmosis and you put them on antitoxoplasma therapy, if you don't see response within 2 to 4 weeks, then probably to confirm your diagnosis, you can do a brain biopsy. These are the differential diagnosis of a ring enhancing lesion, which I'll just show in the next one or two slides. If you can have the ring enhancing lesions on a CT, the various differential diagnoses like metastasis, tuberculoma can be diagnosed. You should think of the following differential diagnosis. Metastasis, again, if they are medium size, primary brain tumor, tuberculoma, fungal granuloma, toxoplasmosis, sarcoidosis, and even demyelinating disorders. Cerebral abscess, tubercular abscess, fungal abscess is also kept in mind when you are dealing with a ring-enhancing lesion. This is an MRI image of a toxoplasmosis. If you see in this A over here, this T1 weighted image, axial MR image shows multiple hypo-intense lesions with perilesional edema. A T2 weighted image, axial MR image shows multiple hyper-intense lesions of varying sizes with marked surrounding vasogenic edema. This is a post-contrast sagittal T1 image showing again multiple lesions with enhancement in the periphery and the center. The characteristic appearance of a MRI finding of a toxoplasmosis is an eccentric target sign, which you can see it over here. The tachocytes are usually located at the periphery of the lesion. This multiplication leads to a condition, a sign called as an eccentric target sign, which can be picked up on MRI. So, which is probably a diagnostic of a toxoplasmosis. This again a diffuse weighted image showing multiple ring enhancing lesions of varying sizes. So this differential diagnosis with the presence of an eccentric target sign, probably you can make a diagnosis of toxoplasmosis. Treatment, sulfadiazine, it consists of an acute treatment and a maintenance. Acute sulfadiazine 4 to 8 grams per day in 4 divided doses, plus pyrimethamine 100 to 200 milligrams per day for 6 weeks, then 50 to 75 milligrams per day for 6 weeks. Sometimes you might not have the availability of the sulfadiazine, pyrimethamine. Alternatives like clindamycin and macrolides, azithromycin, clarithromycin have been used along with pyrimethamine. The next best option is the use of cotrimoxazole, but other options are usually less efficacious, that is clindamycin and macrolides. This is the initial acute treatment for toxoplasmosis. You follow it up with pyrimethamine 25 to 50 milligrams per day plus sulfadiazine 0.5 to 1 gram 6th hourly. All patients require prolonged suppressive therapy following cure. This may be withdrawn only after improvement with ART and CD4 rising to more than 250 and maintained for at least 6 months. You should follow up the patients. Approximately 86% of patients show clinical improvement by day 7 of treatment and 95% show radiographic improvement by day 14. If these things are not seen, failure to respond within 40 to consider alternative diagnosis. This is a situation where probably a brain biopsy might help. Next, another illness is your progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, late manifestation seen in about 4% of patients with AIDS. Pathogenesis caused by JC virus. This JC stands for John Cunningham virus, also called named after the person who suffered from this. It's a DNA virus belonging to the human papillomavirus. It's the only known complication of this virus, progressive multifocal encephalopathy. 90% of the general adult population is already exposed to this virus in the early childhood and contains antibodies. So as a result of immune suppression, they can lead to the development of PML. Lesions, they usually present a small foci of demyelination in subcortical white matter. They have a protracted course with multiple neurological deficit, multifocal like seizures, visual field defects, aphasia, ataxia, and occasional sensory deficits with or without mental state changes. You should investigation when you are suspecting a patient with progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, you should get a CT and an MRI. MRI usually shows multiple non-enhancing white matter lesions which coalesce prediction for occipital and the parietal lobe. MRI shows decreased signal intensity on T1 and hyper-intense lesion on T2 weighted images. CSF findings are usually non-specific. Again, CSF PCR for JC virus can be done in certain special situations. Brain biopsy if clinical diagnosis is likely, but no viral DNA detected on the CSF. This is a MRI image of a patient with progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Characteristic finding is a multiple areas of high signal intensity on flare-weighted images localized to the subcortical white matter without any mass effect. This shows a T2 flare-weighted brain shows white matter hyperintensity on the subcortical fibers, the splenium of corpus callosum in the posterior cerebral hemisphere. This is the characteristic finding of a patient with PML. So once you have made a diagnosis of PML, you have to treat. No specific therapy for PML. Improved earlier to the initiation of heart, majority of the patient had the mean survival rate of only 3 to 6 months. Now with the initiation of heart, the disease has been, you see the patient surviving up to almost 7 to 15 years. Patients on heart may show, however, we should be very careful when initiating these patients with heart when you make a diagnosis. Particularly, PML can be a manifestation of IRIS also. Only 50% of patients in heart show any neurological improvement. Various other therapies have been tried or with not much good result, like acyclovir, vidrabin, interferon alpha have been tried without much neurological improvement. Primary CNS lymphoma should be thought of. Again, it complicates the course of AIDS in up to 5% of the patient. Pathogenesis, this primary CNS lymphoma of B cell origin are considered as opportunistic infections. The clinical features are similar to toxoplasmosis. They present to you with headache, fever, focal neurological deficiencies. So this primary CNS lymphoma also should be kept as a DD in a patient who presents with fever, headache and focal neurological deficiency or even a seizures. So differentiation between toxoplasma and lymphoma, these are a few differences. The site of lesion, usually the toxoplasma is less than 4 centimeters, lymphoma are more than 4 centimeters. The number of lesions in toxoplasmas, as I showed you, there are multiple ring enhancing lesions, whereas here it's only solitary or a few, one or two lesions can be present in lymphoma. Distribution, basal ganglia and gray-white interface, where this is, it's usually the periventricular area which can, the lymphoma can be affected. There can be edema in toxoplasmosis, not to a good extent in lymphoma. Enhancement, it's a thin-walled ring-enhancing lesion in toxoplasmosis, whereas in a lymphoma, it's an irregular, thick-walled, heterogeneous lesion. Mass effect is seen in toxoplasmosis. It is less common in lymphoma. If you do a MR spectroscopy, the lymphoma usually shows an increased metabolism. Corpus callosum is rarely involved in toxoplasmosis. It is usually involved in lymphoma. These are a few differences between toxoplasma and lymphoma when you want to have difficulty in diagnosing. Investigation, MRI and CT, CSF, unhelpful, monoclonal B lymphocytes by flow cytometry can be give you an evidence of primary CNS lymphoma. Brain biopsy is usually definitive after a failed therapeutic trial for toxoplasmosis. PET scan, as I already told you, might be an increased metabolism can be seen in this patient. This is a neuroimaging in a patient with primary CNS lymphoma, which is characteristic of a CNS lymphoma. You can see over here, there is a solitary large ring-enhancing lesion with mild mass effect and moderate vasogenic edema. The hypotensity of the intensity of the lesion on T2 weighted images. You can see the same lesion on T2 weighted images, characteristic of a lymphoma. Note that the mass effect and edema is less than expected given the size of the lesion. The size is quite big, but even the mass effect and the edema is less, which is characteristic of a primary CNS lymphoma. If the same thing would have thought of a toxoplasmosis, there would have been a mass effect, all those things would have been there. If you see this figure, shows left temporal lobe vasogenic edema. There are also bilateral lesion in the caudate nucleus on the T2 weighted images. The caudate nuclei over here, if you can see. So, involvement of this caudate nuclei with periventricular and ependymal extension of enhancement on right is a characteristic feature of primary CNS lymphoma, which is not seen in toxoplasmosis. Treatment, heart, vigorous attempts to suppress the CNS replications, mass effect, high dose corticosteroid therapy, radiotherapy, palliative whole brain radiotherapy is done, and chemotherapy usually remains controversial and usually in the trial stages. Identification of primary CNS lymphoma is very, very important. The next most common disease is the vascular myelopathy. We know HIV involves the cord per se. These patients, as I told you, the most common disease are HIV, vascular myelopathy, and sensory ataxia like disease and dysesthesias. Vascular myelopathy is the most common cause of spinal cord dysfunction. Patient usually can present to you with a pyramidal tract type of weakness, ataxia, particularly a sensory ataxia due to involvement of the posterior column, and the tingling and numbness probably due to involvement of the peripheral nerves. It is apparent in about 25 to 55% of AIDS autopsy series, frequently coexists with HIV encephalopathy. Onset is usually subacute. One of the important EDs which you should keep is a subacute combined degeneration due to vitamin B12 deficiency, where the patient can have similar features of pyramidal tract weakness, ataxia, and peripheral nerve involvement. Gait disturbance, ataxia, spasticity, sphincter dysfunctions are quite common. On examination, you can have spasticity, hyperreflexia, extensor plantar, and loss of posterior column, that is proprioception and the vibration sense due to the posterior column involvement. No sensory loss level is usually seen in these patients. Investigation again is non-specific to exclude other causes mainly. In a background of HIV, you have these signs, rule out one of the important differential diagnosis for a non-compressive myelopathy. MRI spine, cord swelling with intramedullary enhancement, T2 signal changes. CSF testing mainly for the other associated viral infection. Treatment is usually initiation of heart viral control can result in improved neurological function is not well documented in these patients. You should take the care of the patient with that neurogenic bladder, the bladder infections, and the prevention of the skin breakdown, development of ulcers, bed sores, and the management of limb spasticity, etc., should be taken care in these patients with vascular myelopathy. This is a characteristic MRI finding. Sagittal T2 weighted images of the cervical spine increase signal on T2 extending from C2 to up to C5. This axial T2 image to be symmetric within the posterior column of the cord is usually seen. That's about the vascular myelopathy. Next most important is your peripheral neuropathy. As I told you initially, complicate all stage of the HIV disease. Symptomatic neuropathies is seen in 10 to 15% of patients. Pathological changes are seen in almost all patients. They vary from distal sensory peripheral neuropathy, AIDP, CIDP, CMV associated polyradiculopathy, and important is your NRTA associated toxic neuropathy, where you can see. In addition, many of these patients are alcoholics, many of these patients are usually diabetes, so you should always rule out peripheral neuropathy due to alcoholism or even diabetes. And the drugs which you use for the treatment of opportunistic infections, like INH in tuberculosis, Dapsone for opportunistic infections, metronidazole, all these things can cause peripheral neuropathy. You should keep DDs for all, you should think of those drugs causing peripheral neuropathy in these patients with HIV. Distal symmetrical polyneuropathy, painful burning sensation, numbness, paresthesias, dysesthesias, depressed or lost ankle jerk, mild pain, vibratory sense, and loss in the feet. Symmetrical involvement. Investigation, typical clinical features are usually diagnostic. You can do many of the nerve conduction studies and see for the damage that has taken place. treatment reduce the exposure to the neurotoxins, particularly ethanol, NRTIs, and the drugs used in the treatment of opportunistic infections like INH, metronidazole, dapsone, and vincristine. These patients should be screened for other disease-producing peripheral neuropathy, vitamin B12, and diabetes. Heart should be initiated as early as possible. For pain control, tricyclic antidepressants like nortriptyline, amitriptyline can help you in some situations. Anticonvulsants like gabapentin also can be used to relieve the pain in these patients with peripheral neuropathy. Stroke in HIV is quite common, though we see many of them. It's attributed to both main ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic strokes are quite common. The hemorrhagic stroke are mainly due to the thrombocytopenia associated with HIV, coagulopathy due to DIC, primary CNS lymphoma, and many of them can also have this history of drug abuse like cocaine, amphetamine, and TTP. All these things can lead to a hemorrhagic stroke. Ischemic stroke can usually occur as a result of various vasculitic syndrome due to varicella zoster, TB, syphilis, or even cryptococcal, non-bacterial thrombotic stroke, endocarditis, and even a procoagulant state can lead to ischemic stroke in a patient with HIV. Seizures, another important neurological manifestations in a patient with HIV. The causes of seizure, whenever a patient with seizures with HIV comes to you with seizures, think of the differential diagnosis. It could be HIV encephalopathy, it could be toxoplasmosis, it could be cryptococcal meningitis, primary CNS lymphoma, and PML. This is the overall contribution to first seizure percentage in these HIV patients. 24 to 47% was seen in encephalopathy. But however, fraction of patients who have seizures is almost 70 to 50%. So keep these differential diagnoses in a patient with seizures, in a patient living with HIV. This is one study which was done in Nimans by Dr. Satish Chandra et al. And published in Neurology Asia. They studied the causes of seizures in a HIV patient. Published in Neurology Asia in the year 2005, they saw CNS tuberculosis contributed to almost 44% of the patients due to causing seizures, followed by cryptococcal meningitis, toxoplasmosis. Then the least common in single digit were the encephalitis, neurosyphilis, herpes, PML, AIDS dementia, ischemic stroke, and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So majority of the causes of seizures are caused by these three diseases, CNS tuberculosis, cryptococcal meningitis, and cerebral toxoplasmosis, which we see them in our clinical practice. The same study they also extended to see the type of seizures. Again, published in the same study, they also saw epitome of the type of seizures in HIV patients. Majority of them had generalized tonic-clonic seizures contributing to almost 62%. The next was the partial seizures in around 37%. The 8% of them had status epilepsy. So you should remember generalized tonic-clonic seizures was the majority of the type of seizures in these patients. Muscle disease. It can produce asymptomatic elevation in creatinine kinase. Subacute syndrome characterized by proximal muscle weakness may be seen after prolonged zidovudin therapy. They are red-ragged fibers or the histological hallmark of zidovudin-induced myopathy. This is usually reversible following discontinuation of the drug. Neuromuscular weakness syndrome can occur as a result of involvement of the muscle disease. The patient usually presents with ascending paresis and areflexia. You do lactate and CPK level are usually raised. Supportive treatment of these patients with riboflavin is recommended. Introduce alternative NRTI after lactate level is normal for the 3 months. The patient can present to you with body ache, pain in the muscles. Remember, it could be due to zidovudin or due to muscles affected by the HIV itself. HIV and eye. Ophthalmic problems occur in about 50% of patients with advanced HIV infection. Most commonly seen are the cotton wool spots and hard white spots that appear on the surface of the retina and often have an irregular edge. These patients, in contrast to CMV retinitis, do not have any visual loss. They represent areas of retinal ischemia secondary to microvascular disease. But however, the most important ophthalmic disease is the CMV retinitis, can occur as an opportunistic infection in patients with CD4 count less than 50. They usually present as painless progressive loss of vision. Very important, the patient complaining progressive, painless loss of vision, suspect CMV retinitis. They usually complain of floaters and scintillators in front of their eyes. The disease is usually bilateral. Characteristic retinal appearance is perivascular hemorrhage and exudate. Visual loss that develops as a result of CMV retinitis is irreversible. This is the characteristic exudate and hemorrhages that you can see in patients with CMV retinitis. Progressive, painless vision loss, suspect CMV retinitis in any patient in a PLHIV. Treatment of CMV retinitis, induction and maintenance. Induction, IV Jansiclovir, 5 mg per kg twice daily for 2 to 3 weeks, then once daily for 5 to 7 days a week. Maintenance capsule Jansiclovir, 1000 mg 3 to 4 times daily. Can be discontinued once the CD4 is increased to more than 100 and sustained for 6 months following antiretroviral therapy. So you should remember the CMV retinitis as one of the causes. Another important finding is the herpes simplex virus and the varicella virus, which can cause a rapidly progressive bilateral necrotizing retinitis in a patient living with HIV. This is called as a progressive outer retinal necrosis or acute retinal necrosis syndrome. It's usually associated with pain, keratitis and iritis. That is where you should remember it's characterized by pain, whereas CMV retinitis never had. It's a progressive painless loss of vision. This disease, progressive outer retinal necrosis, is complicated by retinal detachment. Treatment with IV acyclovir as quickly as possible to minimize the loss of vision is the what you have to do in these patients. So these are the few common neurological manifestations of a central nervous system in a patient living with HIV. A few slides about neuroiris. Neurological manifestation can present you as IRIS in a patient with patient living with HIV. A positive, how to make a neuroiris definition? Positive response to ART with evidence of controlled HIV replication. There must be neurological manifestation with a close temporal relationship between ART initiation and disease onset. Evidence of inflammatory reaction demonstrated by MRI or CNS histopathology, exclusion of the other differential diagnosis. Neuroinflammatory disease driven by IRS, its frequency of IRS among HIV infected patients varies from 0.9 to 1.5%. Usually, some studies have shown even up to 16%. It's of clinical interest because the disease that usually manifests is very severe. And whatever we see, the neurological manifestation occurring as a result of IRIS usually has an unfavorable prognosis, frequently resulting in severe neurological disability or even death, as one study published in 2009. So we should keep in mind neuroiris in making a diagnosis. As well, they can present you as both the unmasking variety and the paradoxical IRIS. So what are the various IRIS, neuro-IRIS that can be presented? You can have neuro-IRIS as a result of viral infection. For example, PML caused by JC virus can be presented as a neuro-IRIS. About 16% of patients with PML worsened due to IRIS. It was published by Muller et al. In the year 2010. You can see IRIS as a result of Mycobacterium tuberculosis. This onset due to JC virus or PML usually occurs within 1 week to 26 months. The treatment is continue and the drugs and the use of steroids. Neuro-IRIS due to tuberculosis affects almost 15.7% co-infected patients with HIV. Manifests as meningitis, tuberculosis, tuberculomas and radiculomyelopathy. Treatment will be again continuation of the drugs and use of steroid. You can have fungal changes, that is cryptococcal meningitis. You can have toxoplasmosis and even candidiasis as a result of IRIS. So you should keep them in mind when you are treating these patients with neurological manifestation. Therapy is corticosteroids, blocking cell migration and neutralization of cytokines. Corticosteroids, prednisolone 1.5 mg per kg per day for 2 weeks, has provided clinical improvement without affecting the mortality of the patients. The blocking the cell migrations, mainly drugs that is anti-4 integrin monoclonal antibody like natalizumab and mavirac have been used. This acts by blocking the migration of the lymphocytes to the inflammatory sites. Natalizumab act by blunting the T cell and monocyte transmigration to the CNS in severe cases of neuro-IRS. Another thing is the neutralization of the cytokines in these patients, the therapy of the IRIS. It's the TNF antagonism, one drug like called as Ankinara, which is IL interleukin 1 receptor antagonist, and neutralization of the interleukin 6 have shown some tried for treatment of neuro-IRIS, since this acts as an anti-inflammatory agent. So main thing is continuation of the treatment and use of steroids and anti-inflammatory agent is the treatment therapeutic strategy for these patients with neuro-IRIS. So the key points: consider your opportunistic infections like cryptococcal meningitis, toxoplasmosis, which are quite common in our tuberculosis when a patient presents with global cerebral syndrome. Toxoplasmosis is a probable etiology in a patient with focal neurological deficit. Tuberculoma can be an important differential diagnosis. Tuberculosis, syphilis, lymphoma is present with neurological manifestation. Seizures, I told you, differential diagnosis of seizures in a patient with HIV. HIV involvement of peripheral nerve is an important causal factor for many manifestations. The drugs used can cause HIV peripheral neuropathy. Ophthalmic examination is necessary to rule out CMV retinitis before initiating ART. Initiate HART as early as possible to prevent the progression of the neurological disease. Thank you.
All the participants are requested to kindly post their queries in this chat box. All the participants are requested to kindly enter the e-poll which is displayed on the screen. Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful session. I once again request all the participants to kindly enter the e-poll.